We're joined by John Giddings, the programmer. Actually, I mean, you've been in the music industry for such a long time, but you're the main man behind the Isle of Wight Festival, really, aren't you?
Well, sadly, I've been in the music business for 40 years. I worked out, I've had my own company for 30 years, and this is the 15th year of the Isle of Wight Festival. So it's like a tennis score, really, 15, 30, 40. So.
Yeah, absolutely. That's right.
But what other thing is there to do in life, really?
Exactly. Talk us through, in the early days of your career, you were already working with some incredible like heritage acts that we look back on now, weren't you?
I was really lucky to get involved in the music business, the year of punk. You know, I walked across the road and the Sex Pistols were playing in a pub near me, and there
Amazing.
Was the Police was starting, U2 was starting, and it was a different era, and you got involved with the adverts, X-Ray Specs, you met the Ramones, Iggy Pop. It was much, much easier. It wasn't guided by lawyers and accountants and dictated. It was more see to your pants and get on with it and make things happen. It was a fantastic era to, you know, the good news about being older is you've lived the golden age of rock and roll, really, having seen Led Zeppelin, The Who, The Stones in those glory years.
Wow, yeah.
It's brilliant, and people still want to hear about it.
Yeah, absolutely, certainly do. And then, I mean, obviously the heritage of the Isle of Wight Festival, everybody knows about that, but in 2002 you were brought in to kind of revive it.
Accident, really, because they asked everyone in the music business to restart the event, and nobody could be bothered to go down there, and I only went for a laugh because I was there in 1970 and saw Jimi Hendrix.
Wow.
And I thought, wouldn't it be good to go on the ferry again, see the sun on the Solent? And when I got there, I thought, well, I've been going to festivals all my life. Why don't I have my own one? And that's the reason I did it, really.
Wow. And what is your memory? I mean, you were just saying the sun on the Solent. I always say, I mean, I grew up in that area, but going to the Isle of Wight Festival is such a treat. It feels like like you're travelling, like almost like a holiday as well, getting to the island, isn't
it? It's magical. It's like going back in time. It's got Carisbrook Castle, Osborne House, Dimbola Lodge, all those beautiful places. It's steeped in history. And I just love the microclimate, everything that goes with it. The people are nice. Mm. And people always said to me that having a festival on a place you can only get to by ferry wouldn't work. But that's one of the attractions.
I think so.
Plus, it's a floating pub.
Exactly.
Which attracts people
exactly.
as well.
Exactly. That's true. So when you took over in 2002, obviously it's just grown and grown and grown in size, hasn't it? And a popularity. And now, of course, we're so excited to be at the Isle of Wight Festival 2016. We're celebrating 40 years of punk, which you were just talking about a minute ago. We've got some incredible headliners. So when does the booking process start? Because I'm thinking it must take about a year, right?
It takes actually longer than a year, because as soon as you finish booking one year, you start obsessing about what's going to be the next one. And I've already made offers to people for 2017.
Right.
It's that far ahead.
Yeah.
You know, sadly, I've been talking to Prince for the last 5 years about doing a Jimi Hendrix tribute, but of course that's never going to come to fruition. But you think about it all the time. It doesn't stop. It never stops. It's like the best hobby you can have in the world.
Absolutely. And if we look at some of the headliners for this year, shall we? I mean, The Who, obviously, I mean, needs no introduction, especially to our audience as well. I mean, they're going to put on a fantastic show, aren't they?
Well, they are it. I mean, Tommy is one of the best albums ever made.
Yeah.
And they are one of the best live bands ever. And then you get to Queen, which, you know, with Adam Lambert, he's one of the few people in the world that can hit those high notes that Freddie did, and he pays tribute to him, and it's an incredible show. And one of the reasons I booked them was because I saw them last New Year's Eve on television, and I thought how good they still are, and I know what it's going to be like when I see 50,000 people singing along.
It's quite euphoric, isn't it, the music of Queen?
Well, they've had 10 number one albums, which isn't bad going.
Yeah, and what a way to close a festival as well. Like you say, Adam Lambert, quite a frontman.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And we will do some kind of tribute to David Bowie, who I represented for 30 years, and he played his last ever UK show at the Isle of Wight, because, you know, he's an incredible artist. I always prayed that he would come back, and sadly, he won't. I mean, that's two people we've lost, and we need to protect those people's careers and keep the iconic nature. Will we ever get those kind of people again?
I know, it's an interesting thought, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. If you look out now, there's certainly new people coming up. You know, we've got bands like Blossoms, we've got Sunset Suns. There's some great new talent out there, but I don't know in 20 years' time who will be at that level of iconic status. It's hard to spot. Ed Sheeran has done pretty well.
You know, obviously those are some of the newer bands playing your festival this summer as well. How do you keep up with the sort of trends? Do you go to loads of shows? Do you keep listening online? Do you listen to the radio a lot?
Well, what happens is someone mentions a group to me and I ignore it. Second time it registers in the back of my brain. The third time I think I should check them out, right, which is what I did with Catfish in the Bottom, for example.
Yeah.
And it just develops and then you check it out. The internet gives you immediate access to everything.
Right.
So for 10 seconds you can listen to someone and know whether you're going to like it or not. You know, when I was a kid growing up, you had to look at the back of Melody Maker or Sounds or NME and go to a show and find out what it was like.
Mm. Sometimes people say to me, oh, you know, like this band, they've got such and such many followers, which doesn't really sort of register with me. It's almost down to the music more.
Yeah, we don't base it on that. We base it on who we think can entertain a crowd in a field and be a great live act. It's not dictated by the charts. You know, the good thing about being older is you book music from past, present and future and combine all the things together. And I want people to move around the site and enjoy different things. I don't want them to stand in front of the main stage and watch 10 acts in a row.
Right.
I want them to go and discover what else is going on, you know, a mile away, which is how long the site is now.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk about Iggy Pop, can we? Because you're celebrating 40 years of punk this year, aren't you, as well? I mean, Iggy, we were just talking before this show about how he played the Royal Albert Hall the other night, one of the gigs of the century, I think you said. I can't wait to see him play the Isle of Wight.
I think that is going to be the gig of the year. It's one of the best shows I've ever seen in the whole of my life. You know, his stamina, his energy. Mm. He spent more time in the audience than he spent on stage. And luckily we filmed it, so it's going to get broadcast. But he's such a good bloke, such a good guy, such a musical talent. And the way he's kept himself fit and can perform to that level of energy is extraordinary. Mm. And Josh Homme produced a great album. He'll be performing some stuff from that. Obviously, some of the older stuff. I mean, The Passenger is one of the best songs ever written.
Ever. Yeah, incredible. And how will that be programmed then with the 40 years? Because you've got lots of different bands from that era playing. I mean, will that be in one particular place or scattered?
It's scattered around the site because, as I said, I want people to move around. But having people like Adam Ant, the Buzzcocks, the Damned, you know, they're people I saw in 1975 when they were playing in the Nashville down the road.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think a punk changed music overnight. Before that, people thought Genesis, Queen, Led Zeppelin, that was it. And then suddenly all these kids got up on stage and they couldn't play really. They just banged it out and it was so exciting. It was so real. And they're all 10 times better now than they were then. It's quite funny looking back on it when people say The Jam were a punk band because they weren't. They were a mod band. It was The Pistols, The Clash, The Damned, really. They were the three. Even The Stranglers were like The Doors. They had keyboards.
Yeah, true. And when you're sort of programming, I mean, you go from like sort of 40 years of punk and bands like we were just talking about to a Pendulum DJ set to then Mike and the Mechanics. I mean, variety is so rife in your sort of lineup this year, isn't it? Which I think is great.
It's for different times of day, for different types of people. Our age range is 15 to 50 and people want different kinds of entertainment. You know, Pendulum are a great dance band. Sigma are a great dance band. You put them on late at night because people want to kick off, they've had a few drinks. And then you put Mike on at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on the main stage and he plays an hour of hits, which everybody knows and sings along to.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. And football. Should we quickly talk about football? Because we were just talking, you were saying, oh, you know, you're not sure on what time the games are going to be and everything. So that's quite tricky, isn't it?
We broadcast the football because people want to see it. Mm. I mean, you don't want 10,000 people walking into town to watch England play on the Saturday
night. Neither does
night.
Yarmouth or Cowes, I should imagine.
It's not just about football. We will screen, there's a new Iggy Pop film called Blood Orange. We're going to screen the David Bowie performance from 2004. We'll have different things going on in the Field of Dreams as opposed to just the football. And you know, good luck to England. What I know about football, you could write on your little toe, so it's pretty hard to talk about it. But I think we should, you know, provide it.
When you start a new year in booking, does it start literally with one sheet? So now it's like 2017, ideas for headliners and then sort of
yeah, I just write it down
that.
On a piece of paper. Everything's written on a cigarette packet, really. You make it up as you go along. And when you book one, you then book a juxtaposition to go with it. You start from, you know, I'd like to book Oasis when they reform. I'd like to book Green Day. I'd like to book Radiohead. All these bands. And it all depends who you get as to what the next one's going to be and how you're going to make it up. It's like putting a jigsaw puzzle together.
Mm. What's been your luckiest mistake?
Ooh, I'm trying to think. Oh, my luckiest mistake was Well, it wasn't a mistake. It was when I had Jay-Z and Kanye West walked on.
Oh, right, yeah, nice.
I didn't pay Kanye West.
Oh, nice.
I don't know whether that's a mistake or not. And I turned around to my left, Beyonce was standing next to me. So
oh, nice.
That was a good moment in
my
life.
Yeah, I bet it was.
Also, when we had the Stones, they weren't going to bring their B stage, you know, the bit that sticks out into the audience. I thought, God, if I get run over on Monday morning, I should have had the whole show, so I paid an extra £100,000 to build a B stage for them to play three songs on, and wow. I don't regret it.
Yeah. Attention to detail, isn't it? And just delivering, like, the best show you can.
You've got to provide a great show with a great sound and, you know, you've got to look after your... We pay £1 million between security and police to keep the audience protected. It's the safest environment you can possibly be in, really, being at a festival nowadays.
Absolutely. And finally, because I grew up on that sort of stretch of the South Coast, I've heard a few rumours about how people kind of get across and like sort of private yachts and boats taking people across. Helicopters must play an important part.
There are different levels of transport across. I haven't seen anybody rowing across yet. We did have a dragon boat race on the River Medina, but yeah, some people will only come if they can fly their helicopter in. We'll accommodate anybody that wants to come, really. You can come on the hovercraft, you can come on the fast cat, the red jet, you know, and the posh people park up the river and try and see the show for free. So I've turned the stage around a bit and grown the trees. They've got the money they should pay.
Absolutely. And just finally, what's the one thing, a hard question, but is there one particular thing that you're looking forward to seeing this year?
Somewhere on the site, there's a World War II bunker, which randomly we... clear a venue and we put all of the audience into this little bunker and Vera Lynn sings to you and you have to drink shots at the same time. You have to find that.
Okay, that's amazing. John Giddings, the countdown is on. Thank you so much. We so look forward to the Isle of Wight. And
thank
thanks
you
for
very
inviting
much
us as well. Absolute.